عملت لحلمي عملت كثيرا وها قد حصل.
ثم أما بعد, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending immense blessings and peace upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, his family, including his wives, and those who follow him until yawm al-qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions in his Quran that he sent it down as a mercy, a guidance, and a cure for mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also described his Quran as something which contains many wisdoms. As he says about his Quran, hikmatul baligha, a perfect wisdom. From one of the purposes of the Quran, other than reciting it, memorizing it, and trying to implement it in our lives, is that we reflect upon the ayats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and some of the lessons we may find in the Quran. As for reflection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ, do they not ponder and reflect upon the Quran? He also says, لِيَتَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, for those who reflect and ponder upon his ayats. And after this reflection, that we try our best to implement what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to do in his Quran. Aisha radiallahu anha, she was asked by her companion, what is the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And she said, his character is that of the Quran. And this hadith is found in Sahih al-Muslim. May Allah make us those who try to implement the Quran. Today I'm going to talk about just one ayah in the Quran. For if you come with the conditions and the implementation of this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have a great reward for us. And the scholars from the past have said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he starts a verse on ayah with Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu, or something similar to it, that this ayah is only directed to the believers and is a privilege for the Muslims only. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Muslims, and that they should listen closely and pay attention to this, because Allah is either going to tell you a command which you should do, or he's going to give you a prohibition. Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَنْ لَا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبَشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَعَدُونَ. Indeed, those who say Allah is our Lord, and then they had istiqamah, angels will descend down upon them and tell them, do not be scared and do not have any grief of the past. Glad tidings for you of paradise which you are promised. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those who come with istiqamah. So when you come with istiqamah, Allah will allow the angels to descend down upon you and give you glad tidings of Jannah. But before you come with istiqamah, Allah placed the prerequisite, and that is Rabbun Allah. Allah is your Lord. You have to proclaim and believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your Lord. When you recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your Lord, and you worship Him as He deserves to be worshipped, and you come with knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you believe that He is your Lord, you believe in His names and His attributes, and you do not deny His attributes, and you call upon His names, and you worship Him alone. All of your acts of ibadah are directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Once you come with this comprehensive worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you come with istiqamah, you will be allowed this reward. Ibn Rajab rahimahullah, what he said about istiqamah is that if the heart is upright upon al-tawheed, then the limbs will be upright in obedience to al-aziz al-hamid, meaning if your heart is good and pure from an Islamic perspective, and you believe Allah is your Lord and you worship Him, then this will be manifested upon your actions and your limbs, and it will be apparent. Istiqamah has been described by many ulama and some sahaba. Abu Bakr and Umar, they described istiqamah as to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obey Him, and to stay within the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to stay away from the prohibitions and the things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited you to do, with knowledge and sincerity, and following the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith which is found in Sahih al-Bukhari, he said there is a piece of flesh in the body that if this piece of flesh is corrupt, the entire body will be corrupt. And if this piece of flesh is good, then the entire body will be good. And this piece of flesh is the heart. As I was saying, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that if your heart is good, then all of your body will be good. And if your heart is bad and corrupt, that all of your body will be corrupt. And today there's a common statement that we hear when people may be sinning, when they advise that don't judge me, only God can judge me, and the likes of it. Really and truly, this is not an Islamic sense, because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith, which is sahih, he said, if you see an evil, stop it with your hands. If you can't, stop it with your mouths. And if you can't, stop it, hate it in your heart, and that is the least of iman. So when you see an evil, we should try to stop it, whatever we are capable of doing. And then that is the least of iman. And Umar radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away and revelation stopped coming down, he said, we judge by the apparent. So when you say only God can judge me and this is, and the likes of this is not an Islamic statement, nor is it something which is true. And the reality of it is when someone is correcting you, they're not really judging you, they're just correcting you and reminding you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the things which the ayah wants is to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and come with istiqamah. Linguistically speaking, istiqamah is described to be something which is upright or to stand up. For example, when you pray in congregation, you may hear the imam before salah will say istaw istaqimu. This means stand up. But in the context of this ayah, it means something slightly different. It means to be upright in your religion, to be consistent in your religion. And what was defined by Abu Bakr and Umar, which is to obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to stay away from the prohibitions with sincerity and knowledge, and according to the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And knowledge plays a key part in this, because without knowledge and without knowing, you will not know the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you may fall into the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you do not know them. And that's why knowledge is a key aspect of this. And knowledge by itself will not get you anywhere. You may know what is haram and what is halal, but you may disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left, right, center. So you need implementation with the knowledge and sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For you can do many good deeds, but if you're not sincere with it, this will not benefit you in any way, shape or form. You may have heard of a story where three men, they were questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah gave one of them knowledge about the Qur'an. Allah said to him, what do you do with the knowledge I gave you about Al-Qur'an? The man said, I taught the people Al-Qur'an. I taught them, ya Allah, for your sake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, you have lied. You do not teach the people for my sake, rather you taught them. So they can say, this person and this person is a sheikh, or what a beautiful voice he has, and this guy is very knowledgeable, and the likes of it. So when you do it, when you do a good deed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keep your intention sincere, and may Allah make us those who are sincere for him. And when we do sins, we should try to keep our sins a secret. For Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a sahih hadith, which is found in Bukhari as well, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may cover your sins at night, but you come out at day and you expose it to the people. And these people are the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive their sins. Because when Allah has covered their sins, they came out to the public and they boasted, or they made their sin public and something which is common knowledge to the people, which Allah basically covered your sins in your private. May Allah make us those who He forgives. And all sins and all good deeds are not the same. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are sins which he described as the destroyers. And there are some sins if you die upon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive you. And sins which are major sins. And some sins, even if you indulge in this, that you have basically declared war against Allah and His Messenger. And good deeds are not the same. Some good deeds are an obligation, and some good deeds are nawafil, and the likes of it. And you should start with the obligations, and then make your way down to that which is not an obligation. From one of the first things you can start is with salah, and salah has a direct link with istiqamah. And this descending down of the angels, when you come with istiqamah and knowing that Allah is your Lord, it happens at three times. The first time is when you're on your deathbed. Imagine you're dying and the angel of death is there before you. This is a time when people will be scared, but imagine the angel is telling you, do not be scared and do not be grieved of what you have done. Glad tidings of Jannah for you, just because you came with istiqamah and Allah is your Lord. The second time is on Yawm al-Qiyamah, when the souls will be resurrected from the grave. Yawm al-Qiyamah is a scary day also. We know the state of the people and even the prophets. For people who go to Ibrahim alayhi salam, they'll say, Ya Khalilullah, O friend of Allah, intercede for us today. And he will say, no, 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 I can't intercede for you today. Allah is angry. I have never seen him this angry. Then they'll go to Nuh, Musa and Isa, and they'll say, O prophets of Allah, intercede for us. And they'll be like, nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. They'll be like, myself, myself, myself. And Isa will say, the Christians have taken me as their Lord. I cannot intercede for you today. And then they'll go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he will say, Ummati, 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 my nation, my nation, my nation. And then he'll go down into sajda for however long Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he goes. And then he will intercede for his nation. And just a side point, just a side point. Every single prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or messenger, I should say rather, he was given a dua in his life, he was given a dua in his lifetime. Generally speaking, the dua of the messengers, they're answered, but they were given one dua specifically. If they were to make this dua, the dua would be answered spontaneously and instantly. And every single messenger of Allah, they used it in their lifetime, except for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He saved it for us on that day, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, when every other messenger, he used it for himself on that day. And at a time like today, many Muslims, they don't really have that love and respect for the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For when they hear a sunnah, they will say it's only a sunnah. But rather, it is something which is great. And from one of the things that the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do, which is found in many hadith books, is that at night he will pray all night, sometimes to be grateful to Allah, and other times for his nation. And sometimes his leg will swell up for how long he was in prayer to us. And today when the kuffar, they come with a negative thing about the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we may make a fabrication up just to defend him. From an example, this could be the marriage of Aisha radiallahu anha. One fabrication which is made when the kuffar say negative things about the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is they say he married her, he married her at 18. That is the fabrication we come with. Rather, the true age of her is known in the hadith books. And this is not something which is should be seen as negative. And this is something which is wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Abu Bakr did not choose that marriage, nor did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam choose that marriage for himself. Rather, this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from one of the wisdoms of that marriage is evident and seen today. But the most person that narrated that hadith from the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is Aisha radiallahu anha. She narrated over 1,000 hadith from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they are found in the hadith books today. The third time when the angel will descend and tell you, do not be scared and do not have any grief of what has happened before, is when the believers will be entering into Jannah. Right before they enter Jannah, they will be told, enter Jannah. And so they will be told, don't be scared and don't have any grief. Glad tidings for you of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he promised you in Jannah something which no eye has ever seen, and which no ear has ever heard, and what no mind has ever imagined. May Allah make us those who are granted Jannah. And just a side point regarding coronavirus. As a nation, al-Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to make wudu many a times, at least 5 times a day. And from amongst this is washing the hands. Al-Islam told us to do these things when there is no coronavirus or when there are no other diseases present. And this is from one of the wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even today when you're just even washing your hands, make sure you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For you could even be rewarded for that. For whatever you do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you have the right intention, it could all be a reward for you, which will help you on the day of judgment, inshallah. And also, don't forget your daily adhkars, which can be found in the footsteps of a Muslim. Wallahi, your daily adhkars are very important. For if you have to recite Surah and the three quls, and Ayat al-Kursi and Surah al-Mulk at night, angels will come down and they will protect you. They will repel all evil, all harm. And if you do the same in the morning, it will be the same thing. No harm, no any evil can come to you if you do your adhkars. And the Quran is a cure, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, and not just a cure for Muslims, even for the kuffar. For there was a man at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was bitten by a scorpion bat, or even a snake bat, which is, and his hadith is in Bukhari as well. And a group of Muslim companions, they came past, and the kuffar said, is there any raqi amongst you? Is there anyone who recites amongst you? And they said, yes. Then Sa'id ibn al-Khudri, radiallahu anhu, he recited Surah al-Fatiha among this man, just three times, with a scorpion bat or a snake bat, and he recovered. Just after reciting Al-Fatiha three times. Of course, for us, it may not take three times because the Sahaba, they were far greater than us. But if you have to do it for a very long time, just recite Quran over yourself. Wallahi, you'll be cured and you'll be healed. And no disease can harm you with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even if this disease was to come to you, it is only by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's not something to be feared.
لأجاريهم قلدت ظاهر ما فيهم فبدوت شخصا آخر كي أتفاخر وظننت أنا